punched him in his arm. The word fag uttered with extra emphasis to demonstrate that, well, I was the man, and that he had just sat a little too close to me as we all piled up in the back of the car. All of my life, I had fought the label that I had just said, though I knew that I was different. With my effeminate voice to my walk, when my grandmother would tell me to stop skipping, Tommy, shut your mouth, when I acted to a flame. And when I was in college and our first campaigns were working against apartheid in South Africa, I remember how it used to piss me off that all the gay white men who would participate in our meetings and sit-ins with their prominent pink triangles pinned to their lapels, there were so many of them. Especially Bruce, with his classic gay mustache, and Jim, with his high, effeminate voice, always preaching socialism, and I remember thinking, why are they polluting our struggle with the albatross of homosexuality, when it was already hard enough to fight apartheid itself? What made them think that they could ever link their struggle with ours? I mean, I could already tell it was making many of my black brothers uncomfortable every time that they raised their voices, but little did I know it was because so many of them were gay themselves. From Bernard, who at nearly 300 pounds was staggering in stature, to Troy, who was a model, Willie, who was so effeminate that my own friends, they started to question why I hung out with him so much, to Sean, who was the one that we all thought was gay, but in the end, well, was the only one who wasn't. It was 1987, 88, 89, and the United States government itself was indifferent to gays and lesbians, equating them with ass-injected disease suckers, as our president and mainstream preachers hypothesized that they were the cause of AIDS, and that God had brought his wrath down on them because of their behavior. I mean, why else would they be dying off in droves? I mean, I don't know how many times I've been questioned or told that I came across gay. How many uncomfortable moments started out across diner tables with queries of, man, we were just all wondering, well, you know, if you were gay or not. I mean, there's a rumor going around because my colors were too loud, my gait too proud, a dress or skirt I wore on a lark, or my voice. How I really used to hate my voice. It was so light. And I started to do what Troy did. I wouldn't answer the question. Being ambiguous was as good as guilty in the eyes of the Inquisitor, especially later, when I started actively working for gay rights. I realize now why Troy didn't tell me, because I was so homophobic then, that at the end of that first year, when he finally revealed that the girlfriend Alexis was really Alex, and that the girlfriend Stacy was actually Stanley, and I remember asking him why. And he said, well, because you would have judged me. And you probably wouldn't have gotten to know me for it, because you would have been afraid of what others would have thought. But most of all, you would have never gotten to know the real me. You would have never gotten to know me. And before I could ever even try to refute him, I just stood there stunned, knowing that there was truth in his words, and how glad I was that he had lied.